there are the closing doors, please.
Turn on TV to hear what's in the papers, whether there's delays on the LIE. You got your day off started right, now night time has come. You need your favorite duo from New York, one Pat and Jamie's New York. Pat and Jamie's New York, yeah, Pat and Jamie's New York. Pat and Jamie's New York, yeah, ooh, I say it again. She's an Eagles fan and he's Canadian. Wow, Pat and Jamie's New York, yeah. Guys, please put your hands together for Pat Kiernan and Jamie Stelter.
The weather was so much better when we did that opening.
Oh my gosh. We had the most beautiful day that day.
Yeah. And now we have tonight. Thank you all for making it here in the rain.
We should say thank you to Leslie Gosch. Go first. Ladies and gentlemen.
Thank you, guys. You guys have a great audience tonight. I'm not going to lie.
Okay.
I vetted them.
That's good.
So this is our second Pat and Jamie's New York.
It is. I haven't seen you all week.
I have missed you.
So I got called for jury duty. And they actually sat me down, and for 10 days, I'm on jury duty.
So this was the funniest thing, because last Thursday was the last time I saw you at New York One. And that morning you said, I have jury duty tomorrow, and I was like, you're never gonna get picked. You're a news anchor, like you're a journalist. You have opinions about the judicial system. They're never gonna take you. Never in a million years.
Here I am.
And then I get an email and it's like, oh, I'll see you for Christmas maybe.
It's like a continuous episode of Law and Order. like that never ends. And I managed to dodge it. Because when I moved here from Canada, I was not a U.S. citizen. I was only a Canadian citizen.
Right.
And so for years and years and years, I was just ineligible. And then I swear it was like the hour that I took my citizenship oath. We were in Manhattan at the time. It was Norman Goodman, the county clerk who always emailed everybody. And
right.
Norman Goodman was on me. And now
that
I moved
gotcha.
To Brooklyn, they caught up to me in Brooklyn too.
And I saw your tweet that you were riding the subway at rush hour. For the first time ever, maybe.
No, it wasn't the first time ever, but you and I have talked about this before, that we're not exposed to how hellish the peak morning commute is, because we're talking about it.
Right.
But
well,
we never
know how bad it is until we see the pictures, and I saw your picture, and I was like, ew.
Yeah, and the G train, I don't know if you know the G train, but the G train runs...
I don't know if you know the G train?
Why not? I know you know the G train. I mean, the audience. The G train could be 10 cars, but they run like 5 instead.
Right. There's been a lot of complaints about that.
Right, because why don't you just add a car? Add one car. Yeah.
Well, we should say that one of our guests tonight, Nick Sandow, who you may know from Orange is the New Black. Who watches Orange is the New Black?
He knows the G train.
So he knows the G train. He is a big subway lover. And so we're going to talk to him later. And I'm also really excited because one of our first guest, who will be out in a little while, is Seamus Mullen, who you may know, he is the chef and owner of Tertulia, this delicious restaurant in the Village, and he also owns El Comado in Gotham West Market. Both are wonderful. You should go if you haven't. And we have a little bit of a history.
You do.
Seamus.
All about food.
Right.
Shockingly.
Right. So I have rheumatoid arthritis, and when my arthritis was bad a couple years ago, I went digging on the internet, as you do, and I found this article about Seamus that was like, I healed my arthritis through eating the right foods.
Did you believe it?
I did, because I was already on that train, but he was like, on a express path. And so I was like, well, if this guy's doing it, I'm gonna do it. And I was like, I'm gonna email him. Maybe he'll write me back and I'll get some more information. I wrote him. I wound up meeting him at his restaurant. He was the most generous, kind human. And so we're gonna talk to him later.
Okay, that was a good tease.
Yeah.
Yeah. are you all familiar with the Charlie Sheen story this week? Yes. The most fascinating thing to me about that was the release that he asked people to sign if they wanted to spend time with him. And yes. And it said at the top, in consideration for the fact that you get to spend time with me. And that was the whole thing. All of this other stuff was because you want to hang out with me.
Are you thinking about making a Pat Kiernan release like that?
Well, I just don't think
if you want to be in the presence of Pat Kiernan.
Right, I think a lot of people would say, then just sit by yourself.
That's very humble of you. I think a lot of people would sign that release.
Some might. But you have to be very confident in how much people want to spend time with you to just put that out in front of them.
Hmm.
I was just thinking that. You ever ridden one of those hoverboards?
Oh my goodness. I actually have not. I'm still working on my balance post foot surgery that I had last year. And I'm always super impressed. I find a lot of like teenagers rolling around the neighborhood in them, like in big groups.
Yeah.
Which is a little bit scary sometimes, I'm not gonna lie.
We've learned this week that the hoverboards are illegal.
Yeah. No more. I guess in the privacy of your own home, you can do whatever you like.
I can't imagine that that's what the NYPD is gonna occupy itself with when they got all the things that I'm worrying about at jury duty.
Well, it's a bit, well, I think now it's like becoming another transportation thing. Like there's cars, there's trains, there's bikes, and hoverboards.
Bikes, which leads us to a big theme of the evening. Last time on Pat and Jamie's New York, we talked about the annoyance of tourists.
Yeah.
And you're laughing because you agree, right?
Yeah.
I mean, especially going into this time of year with as soon as the Macy's parade happens, all tourist hell breaks loose.
Tomorrow is one of your favorite days. It is the first gridlock alert day of the season.
It's my birthday tomorrow. That's what you were going to say. That's why it's my favorite day. And it is the
first.
It really is the first gridlock
really
alert day of the season?
It is really the first gridlock alert day. And I thought, you know what? They did that for you.
Not that I like gridlock, I think it's ridiculous that we pick these particular
days. Well, every
day
is gridlock,
right,
around this time.
Especially around the holidays, because the Rockefeller Center tree is the center of all traffic hell.
Right.
It all emanates from there. Because somebody's driving by and they don't even realize that they're going to pass the tree, and then they get to that block and they look over, there's the tree! And they slam on the brakes.
Yeah.
And then nobody on 50th Street can.
And then it's like, stop, get your camera out, hurry up.
Terrible. Can I hang on, one other thing? You know what, last week when they did the thing where they test the balloons, they say that they're having the balloon inflation test?
Yeah.
I don't believe for a minute that that's a test.
What do you mean?
The balloon's already tested, it's just a PR thing.
Really?
I don't think they're really tested. Why would they have to bring the balloons to the middle of the Shea Stadium parking lot or the City Field parking lot to test them? Thank you.
And you called me skeptical. I don't know how many of you watch us in the mornings on New York One, but there was a poll. There was a poll.
This is the Pat and Jamie show. What? The wrong place.
But the Staten Island Ferry was choosing new seats to put in the ferry, and they put a poll up saying, choose whatever seat you think. And I said, I bet the poll is a fraud. They already have the cheapest seat chosen, but they're gonna let you think that you get to choose the seat. And you were like, that's so skeptical. But now look at you.
We can switch roles sometimes.
The balloon test isn't a balloon test.
I don't think it is. Okay, so can I come back to the bike thing?
Please.
So bikes is one of our themes this week because you either hate the bikes, you love the bikes, you ride bikes, you don't ride bikes, but it's such a change from 5 or 10 years ago that bikes are everywhere all seasons now mm-hmm. in the city.
So we went out to see what people think of it.
Here's some of New York's opinions on bikes in New York.
We're here on the Upper East Side of Manhattan talking to pedestrians and cyclists alike about their experiences traversing the busy streets of New York City.
Well, the cyclists are out of hand because, you know, you're looking that way and then here comes one this way.
I mean, I feel like a lot of the delivery guys, they work very hard, but they don't always pay attention. They go right through the, like, red light.
One is cars are always, like, stopping in the bike lane to double park, let somebody out, let somebody in. If they could stop doing that, that would be really good.
They always yell to me. I don't know other people, but I always be yelled.
Bike riders yell at you?
Yeah, and I feel uncomfortable.
Because you step in the bike lane?
Maybe.
Well, the cyclists drive like kamikaze drivers, and the pedestrians are always on their cell phones.
So what could they do to make things safer for you?
Number one, ban them from using the cell phone while they're walking. And number two, give them moving vehicle tickets for bicycles. They're going to die.
Ban it.
So applaud if you think we need more bike lanes. Oh, all right.
Wow.
Applaud if you'd be happy if there was never another bike in your way when you're driving.
Okay. That sounds 50-50.
Yeah, it really does.
But that was almost what we found when we went out that day, was that it depends who you talk to, but it's a really mixed.
There's only a small number of people who are in the middle. It's a very polarizing issue.
It is. Well, I'm interested to see how many of the tourists coming here for Thanksgiving will use city bike.
Combine tourists and bikes. Okay.
But I think that that's when things get even more interesting. Because it's one thing if you know New York and you get on a city bike. It's another thing if you don't know New York and you're like, I'm going to go out on a bike.
Yeah, they should be confined to Central Park. Go around as many times as they want.
That was like on our last show when Alan Coulter's wife said that the sidewalk should be split down the middle, New York City residents, tourists. Yeah. Oh, look at that. People like that.
Absolutely. Well, we're also going to chat bikes with our first guest.
We are.
Should we get to it?
Yeah, so it's no surprise if I'm telling you how healthy of a person Seamus is, that he loves to bike. And when I say loves to bike, I mean loves to bike. Every day he's on his bike, multiple times a day.
So we had a conversation with Seamus Mullen specifically about biking, but before we did that, I strapped the GoPro to the front of a city bike. and I just wanted to bring you on a tour of what a New York cyclist goes through. I rode for just 10 minutes last week, trying to capture some of the frustration of biking in New York traffic. Yes, I forgot my helmet. I try to carry it with me. It's not really an excuse, but it's hard when city bikes are on every corner, but helmets aren't. Within seconds after getting on the bike, I see the most common law-breaking behavior for cyclists, rolling on at a red light or a stop sign. Some cities have actually decided that this is legal if you do it carefully. Not acceptable to me in any way is going the wrong way on a one-way, especially dangerous to others if you are traveling fast. Of course, there were taxis and pedestrians in the way of the bicycle, and it seems like there's always a delivery truck in the bike lane. We met Seamus Mullen outside his restaurant, Tertulia, to talk about the good and bad of biking in New York City.
Well, I ride every day. I run my bicycle every day. So I commute by bicycle from Brooklyn here every day. And then if I'm running errands around the city or going to the other restaurant, I'll be on the bike. But the more that people ride bikes, the fewer cars we'll need in the city. And I think that that's really important. I ride really defensively and expect that someone's going to pull into the bike lane or someone is going to. My favorite move is when they're passing you and you know they're going to make a left-hand turn and you're like 10 feet from the intersection. And so then they pass you, and then they have to stop because they're pedestrians, and then you're just T-boned. And that happens pretty much every day. Yeah. So
that's frightening, because you have to make the decision, are you going to try and outrun them and get around them to keep going straight, or are you going to pause? But the pause is dangerous also.
Or are you going to go to traffic on the right-hand side and then deal with getting nailed by a car coming by you? I got nailed like a month ago in a hit and run by a taxi. Literally, I really feel like as cyclists, we have to, like this guy's going the wrong way, see? Or riding on the sidewalk, we have to obey, and this guy's riding on the sidewalk, see? There, well, thank God, he's parking. You have to obey the traffic laws, and particularly now that a moving violation on a bicycle is treated the same way as a moving violation of a car, and it will go on your license, you really need to respect that.
It's a zoo out here.
My biggest pet peeve is cyclists that weave in and out of traffic and run through red lights willy-nilly and make a bad name for other cyclists, because I think that feeds a lot of the tension between motorists and cyclists. It's definitely, you know, it would be great if they could switch it over here so we have bike lanes on both ends. Going through
city bike dog walking.
Oh, there we go.
Look at that.
Look at that. Want some dog?
That is so cute.
And through the red light he goes.
With the dog.
With the dog.
Right through the red light at the end.
All right, ladies and gentlemen, please welcome to the stage chef, cyclist, our friend Seamus Mullen. Yay!
Welcome. Thank you.
Yeah. That dog was really cute.
Very cute, but should not have been running in traffic.
No.
Is there any point at which the cyclists and everybody else can live in harmony, or is it just destined to be like this? Other than Amsterdam or something.
They do it well in Amsterdam, don't they?
I don't know.
They do.
It seems like they do it really, really well. It's a long culture of cycling. You know, I think that we can, but there has to be a moment where everybody's got to give something. It's all about a little bit of compromise.
Well, I was saying, I think that the best way or the only way to move forward is if everyone tries it. And I'm not even the biggest bike advocate, but I just think that in the times that I've tried it, you see things that you otherwise would never have thought of before you actually got on a bike and see how cars behave, see how people walking and being on their cell phones behave, mm-hmm. which I hate to say is me a lot of times.
Yeah, smartphones, dumb people. Every day.
There's no way some of the wrong way on the one-way cyclists have ever driven a car. Because they wouldn't do that if they understand how vulnerable they are. They think that you're looking for them, but you're looking for 20 other things.
I think the real issue is that when you're riding the wrong way on down a one-way street, and somebody's pulling out, they're not looking in front of them. They're looking behind them to see if there's a car coming. And I've seen a lot of cyclists get hit that way. So there are lots of little things that when you're riding a bike, you really have to be aware of. I mean, it's good to put yourself in the position of the cab drivers and pedestrians and motorists. But in the end, I feel very strongly that cycling is really important for the future of our city and for the future of everything. I mean, it's obviously the most, the greenest way to get around.
Well, I think someone agrees with you because they keep making and painting more bike lanes. I mean, slowly, but it is happening. Mm-hmm.
Okay, so Seamus, I got to take you back to the story that Jamie was telling earlier, that she, out of the blue, sends you an email, I guess, and says, hey, I want to talk about mm-hmm. food and diet and what you can do for me. Were you really that nice to her? did you recognize her from TV, so you were nice to her because of that? Or are you just a nice guy?
Didn't watch TV and I didn't know.
He's just a nice person. Is that so hard to believe?
No, you were just so effusive about it.
Hey, listen, I've had some people that have been incredibly generous and helpful to me, and when I was really battling with RA, you feel like you're alone. I didn't know anyone else that had it. And so when I reached out to other folks who then were super supportive to me, I felt like there was a bit of a community. I don't know, I feel a responsibility as well to help other folks. I've been able to make a lot of progress with the disease, and I feel as though what I've done is totally replicable, and I'd like to be able to help other people with that.
Next time on Dr. Oz. No, can you, I'm just gonna step out of the discussion, but can the two of you explain what the logic behind this is?
You're much better at explaining this than I am, I think.
Well, RA is an autoimmune disease, so the body is attacking itself. And like a lot of other autoimmune diseases, it often is driven by the general state of health of the body. And I believe very firmly that you are what you eat. On a basal cellular level, what you eat becomes who you are. And if you're putting garbage in
you're going to get a lot of garbage out. So the first thing we can do, anyone for their health, but particularly for people that are dealing with an inflammatory, a systemic inflammatory disease, is really try to care for their body and reduce as much systemic inflammation as possible. And the foods are a great way to start with that.
Okay. It does make sense, but here's what I can't reconcile, because I've seen what Jamie eats for breakfast in the morning or for lunch, and it's, let's just say it's healthier than what I would eat, which is fine because that's Jamie. You're running a New York City restaurant, so how much does what you choose to eat yourself cross over into what you're serving? What do you learn from this in terms of how you serve the people?
A lot does. I mean, you know, a big point was changing the way I eat in terms of how the content of what I was eating. So instead of having a lot of carbohydrates, I moved to a much more of a vegetable-based diet with some healthy meats and healthy fats. So in just the composition of dishes at the restaurant, I've taken away a lot of the large portions of carbohydrates and moved them into a smaller kind of supporting actor role. And same thing with the proteins. Instead of having a massive piece of meat all the time, using smaller amounts of meat, using it as an ingredient in a dish. And I've certainly, you know, there are things that I can't make wholesale changes at the restaurant that reflect the way that I eat, but there's a lot of how I do eat that, you know, and my own philosophy about food that is reflected in the menu. And certainly the quality of the ingredients, I think, is the most important thing. Knowing the provenance of your food and the quality of those ingredients is really important.
You should see me when I go to Tertulia or El Camado, either one of his restaurants, and I'm like, give me one of everything, because it's Seamus's restaurant, and I'm like, if he thinks it's good and he's gonna serve it, I'm gonna eat it, and it's really good. So speak, but let's talk.
You know, so I mean, I can slip things in on you now. You're just asking.
But we should talk about restaurant behavior a little bit, because raise your hand or clap your hands if you've been out to eat. I guess this week, since Monday, have you been out to a restaurant to eat dinner this week?
Okay,
good. So I'm wondering, from your point of view as a chef and a restaurant owner, what is the worst or one of the worst behaviors of someone dining in your restaurant? Besides, like, the obvious, like being a jerk to your staff or something.
The guest is always right. You know, what's amazing is we sometimes get these people that come in and are really, really sweet, and then somehow 7 bottles of wine later, they're not really sweet. And it's I can't believe it happens, but it happens frequently.
Well, it's not me, because I don't drink.
So. No, of course it's not you.
I said I was sorry, Seamus.
Sorry doesn't count.
You said you wouldn't bring it up here.
Or gin.
Are there things people could do better?
Is
the classic New York high maintenance, I need this modified and this modified and this modified, is that a problem?
I actually am one of those people that modifies everything when I go to restaurants, so I can't complain about that. I do feel like if you're going out to dinner and you're paying money for dinner, you should be able to get it as close to how you want it as possible. So if you have a nut allergy, or you don't eat pork, or whatever the case may be, if the dish can be modified in such a way that the dish is not going to be ruined. What I remember a long time ago, many, many years ago when I worked in Midtown, I had a woman who'd come in every day, and she would order steamed spinach and steamed octopus with no salt, no vinegar, no oil.
Good for her.
Yeah, exactly. And every time we would make it for her just like that, and she'd send it back and say it tasted like nothing. And then she would come back every day and order it. And at some point, it's like, well, you're setting yourself up. I mean, dishes exist in a composition for a reason. But that's an extreme case. If somebody has a food allergy or shellfish allergy or whatever it might be, obviously we're going to make adjustments to it.
What do you think of the whole tip included or no tipping, whatever we're calling it?
Yeah, this is crazy that Danny Meyer did that.
Yeah, well, I'm glad that Danny's been the first one to put his foot forward on that.
Your foot is not leaping forward till
No way.
Danny's
Are you kidding?
Foot gets...
Well, he's got the advantage of, you know, he has a bunch of fast food restaurants, and minimum wage in the fast food restaurants has just been raised to $15 an hour. So we're looking at that is eventually going to start to affect owner-operated restaurants in New York City. The tipping thing has been, you know, that's been how it's done in Europe for ever, as long as there have been modern restaurants. I think it's going to be really hard for New Yorkers to swallow a $56 entree or a $60 entree.
But people were saying that if you already tip 20% at the end of a meal, that it winds up adding up to be the same at the end? It doesn't.
I don't think so. I mean, not if you factor in all of the back of house employees who, unfortunately, the reality is in New York, they make very, very little. They work extremely hard and they make very little. And I think it's going to be really hard for servers who are making $250 a night in a really busy restaurant to suddenly say, okay, I'm going to be okay with making $160 a night to make that adjustment. It's going to be really hard. It's going to take time, and I hope that it does happen. Although I do like that we live in a service environment because in our restaurants we're a pooled house. So if you're not working for the tip, you're working for the team.
Right.
And I think that's really important. I've worked in restaurants where they're not pooled houses, and everybody is just kind of on their own, and they'll tip out their back waiter as much as they feel like that person deserves. But we have a point system, and everything goes into a pool, and then people, depending upon seniority and what their role is, they're issued a certain number of points in the tip pool. And that works pretty well. I mean, it works quite well for us, and it works well for most of the restaurants in New York. The big issue is that there's two things that are at play, and one is the minimum wage issue, and the other is the tip issue, and they're not unrelated. They're very related. But it's challenging. Operating a restaurant in New York City is incredibly, incredibly difficult. You know, the rents here, we have to compete with Duane Reade and banks, and that's what's replacing almost every small restaurant. So you've got landlords who know they're sitting on very, very wealthy real estate, and you have restaurants that they open, and their busiest year is year 1 through 3, and then after that, their business kind of tapers like this. Meanwhile, all their costs keep going up and up and up.
Well, there was an article I was just reading, I think it was when Kinshop announced it was closing, mm-hmm. that said there's this race for everyone to always be eating at the hottest restaurant, and so it's hard to sort of maintain that long term after that original big opening.
Right, there's this feeling that you can't go somewhere twice because there's 100 new places.
New places you got to check out. Yeah, exactly. And there's also, the other part of it is that we, foolish restaurant operators, keep opening more and more restaurants. And we do it because, as I said before, as your costs go up over time, you have employees, you want to reward them, but it's hard to give people raises and promote them within an organization if your costs are, you know, going up and your sales are stabilized. But if you open a new restaurant, you create opportunities for people. And we end up opening restaurants primarily so that we can retain good people. But then that means there's a proliferation of restaurants, and in New York we have so many dining options, really, really good dining options, that everyone wants to go to the newest place.
And can you tell us about what you're going to be opening?
Sure.
Are we allowed to talk about that?
Sure, we can talk about it.
Okay, good. I didn't ask you ahead of time.
That's fine. Of course, I'm just as guilty because I'm opening another restaurant. In next summer we're opening a restaurant in the Brooklyn Bridge Park. So it's going to be a
Brooklyn.
Yeah, that's right. Finally, I live in Brooklyn. It's around the corner from me, so it'll be nice. It's going to be in the park itself, and this is going to be a restaurant that is very focused on the way that I eat and what I eat.
Yeah.
In a refined.
Where's my husband? Right. We're going to be going there a lot.
Yeah, where's Brian's up? There he is. Right on.
I have one thing on my list before we wrap up with you, Seamus. Jamie was asking about your morning smoothie.
I make the same one every single day for Brian and I, and all of you should be following Seamus on Instagram. He uses a hashtag that says real food heals. Mm-hmm. And you always have so many great ideas. So I want to bug you for one go-to smoothie recipe before you go.
Yeah, this is an easy one. And it's one that I do a couple times a week. So it's a little coconut oil, frozen blueberries, kale, parsley, ginger, almond butter, almond milk.
I think that's all the stuff we have in our house anyway.
Well, there's like 15 other ingredients too. You want me to go through those? No, that's the basic. And you can put a little honey in if you want it to sweeten it up a little bit, but that's about
it. I'm going to get the whole list from
you. Yeah, we'll put it on patandjamie.com.
We'll put it on our website after.
Okay. Seamus, thank you for sharing your
secrets. Thank you.
So wonderful.
Good to see you.
Safe cycling to Seamus.
He rides, we didn't say, he rides 250 miles a week.
A week, yeah. Our next guest is here to tell a story. Caitlin Brodnick does this a lot. She's the co-creator of an all-female storytelling show at the Upright Citizens Brigade.
And she's also a MOTH performer.
Yes.
Yeah, give it up for MOTH.
Here with us to tell us her view of life in New York. Please welcome Caitlin Brodnick.
Hiya. York City for myself, but like really for a guy. There was this guy and he was so cool. I mean, he is so cool. He's still alive. He was just so smart and he was a feminist and he cared about women's feelings. So I was moving to New York City and I had a sublet in this exotic place called Astoria, Queens. I was like, what is this? I'll do it. So I was gonna move in with three other girls and they seemed super cool. And one was kind of bookish and one was a model. And I was like, we're just like Sex in the City. This is gonna be the best time of my life. So before the sublet was ready, I stayed with this boy I really liked, Alan, and we were in Brooklyn, which was also ultra cool, and we all lived in a one bedroom that was, we all slept in the same bedroom. And next to that bedroom was one bathroom. So when you're first dating somebody, you want to be exotic. You know, you want to be fresh, cute, you want to have your best self. And for me, my best self isn't when I go to the bathroom. I don't know about you, but it's like not when I'm in my prime. So I was scared shitless. I did not want to use the restroom when Cool Alan was sleeping in the other room. So I only ventured a block around our apartment because I was a little nervous. I'm not great with numbers. I'm a little dyslexic, so I just knew where we lived and then where I could use the restroom in a like two block radius. But it's okay because it's New York City and things are going to change. I'm going to have new friends. I can't wait. So I was invited to a luau with these new cool girls from Astoria. And I couldn't wait because I was gonna be able to take Alan to this new party with my new friends. And then we'd like make jokes and it would be so fun. So I had to pick out something to wear. I wanted to look very cool, but I also wear a lot of sequins and hot pink. And as soon as I moved to the city, I realized New Yorkers wear black. So I had one dress, but it was like kind of smelly. And then I had a gingham shirt, but gingham with my freckles make me look a little slow. So it's, I don't believe in the stereotype, but I look a little, you know. And so, also, this was 2007, which was the birth of the skinny jean, and it was also the beginning of the trend when people started to ask me if I was pregnant. I'm not kidding. So girls, you know, if you have a great new skinny jean, before they added Lycra to them, you have to convince it to come up your thigh, and then by the time you've wrapped it around your waist, there's like a little like lovey muffin top, and at this point in my life, I was so in love, I gained 10 adorable pounds. And that was Ben and Jerry, and a little bit to Alan and some fried chicken, and I was just so happy and living it up. So I wore a flowy shirt, and that's when people started asking me if I was pregnant. And to be totally honest, guys, I'd rather look pregnant than like sad and fat. I know, I'm such a terrible person. But if you're pregnant, that means somebody's had sex with you. You're creating a life, so your life is worth something. You're probably sober. And if you're super sweaty, everybody knows why. I was like, that would be great. Also, it was some adorable pounds I gained, but it was also some pounds by like sitting at home. I didn't have a job. I missed my mom. I had no friends. That was also like under that. So it wasn't like fun weight gain. It was also really sad. So, but this was going to be different. So I put on the skinny jeans and then I put on a hoodie to look like I have a boyfriend. And I can wear his things. But it was my hoodie. It was my hoodie. I put on some cool jewelry that I just bought off the street, you guys, because you can do that in New York. And I open the door and Alan looks at me and he crinkles his nose and he goes, huh, kind of Mr. T. And I was like, oh my God, I was mortified. I burst into tears because yeah, I looked ridiculous. I was in New York City for the first time. I didn't know anybody. I didn't know how to buy a skirt. I was lonely. I missed my mom. I missed my cousins. And I just start crying because the coolest person in the world saw directly through me and who I was. And it's not like a delicate single tear cry. It's like mascaras everywhere. There's a lot of snot. And I start to look like a victim in a horror movie who may or may not be pregnant. It wasn't pretty. So Alan stops me and he goes, Caitlin, we don't have to go to this party. And I was blown away. I was like, wait a second. You saw that I was uncomfortable, care about my feelings, and are willing to change a plan? Let's get married! Oh my God! And I was so enthralled. I was like, oh my God, we are definitely going to this party because I am showing you off, and we're gonna joke about looking like Mr. T, and I'm gonna have new Sex in the City friends, and it'll be great. So I redo my makeup, lots more mascara. We walk out, and it's a day
where it starts raining just like today, you guys. The wind is sideways, the rain is up and down, and again, the mascara is everywhere. And Alan and I look at each other and we're like, oh God, we're not leaving, we're not leaving. And we just start cracking up, and I go home and I change out of my clothes. I put on Alan's favorite outfit, my pajamas, and we sit down and order some Chinese food, just like real New Yorkers. He couldn't believe I hadn't watched The Big Lebowski, so we had to see it. I fell asleep in the middle of it. Those girls and I never really ended up becoming great friends. They all left the city within 6 months. Alan and I have been in the city for 10 years, and we did get married, but I still can't use the bathroom around him. M'lady, thanks, guys. Thank you guys so much.
That's a good ending.
I know. Did you see? I was like, oh, I didn't hear that story before. I was really...
No, we specifically left it so it'd be fresh.
Yeah. I did happen to check my phone. It's sitting right here. And there's a lot of people using the hashtags.
Yes.
I want to remind you that we have the hashtag Pat and Jamie, which you can ask us questions through.
Oh, yeah. And if you don't want to tweet, you can use one of these cards and write a question for the end of the show.
We're going to take audience questions at the end, and you can ask us whatever you want.
Well,
we get to choose whether or not we're going to answer them.
We'll filter them.
But you can ask whatever you want.
Our next guest is a familiar face. He plays Caputo, who's the prison administrator on Orange is the New Black. He's a guy who grew up in the Bronx, and he has seen a lot of changes in New York.
One of those changes is the decline in the mafia. And I actually watched his new film the other night. He wrote it, he directed it, he stars in it. It's called The Wannabe. It debuted at Tribeca earlier this year, but its big release is coming up on December 4th. It's the story of a young man who admires the mafia and wants in.
Yeah, he wants in. He's the wannabe. Here's a clip from The Wannabe.
Where are you from?
From the Bronx.
Bronx. Then what are you doing here?
I'm celebrating.
Celebrating? No. This is a private block party.
I was invited by Junior.
Wait. You saying you're with Junior? Am I stuttering?
Hey,
are you with Junior?
He's with me, Jerry. He's with me.
What do you mean?
Here. Got a problem with my friend? You go in the hunt club. Your Tommy's with me. Move it.
Yeah.
So what? You're just gonna stare at me all night?
You want to split this?
You're skinny, you gotta eat that. What's your name?
Thomas. Thomas. It's yours.
Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Nick Sandow. The movie set in 1992.
That's right.
It seems so long ago when you see that up on screen and see how New York has changed even in that many years.
Yeah, it was not easy to find 1992 in New York City anymore. I mean, you have to go out in the boroughs. You have to go out in Brooklyn and Queens and the Bronx. You can still find it, but it's not that easy.
Anything in particular that you were looking for that was a frozen in time piece of New York?
Well, the mob. Italian social clubs are...
Italian social clubs!
That was totally a slip. I'm going to get... Jeez. Yeah, Italian social clubs are just so particular to New York and the outer boroughs, and they have not changed at all. And if they have, it doesn't matter.
You told me you shot in almost all five boroughs.
Yeah, we did. We shot... Well, we didn't... poor Staten Island. We didn't make it out to Staten Island. We shot up in the Bronx. We shot up in a courthouse up in the Bronx by Yankee Stadium. We shot out in Bay Ridge, out in Queens. Yeah, we were all over the place.
Patricia Arquette was fantastic.
Yeah.
I was just watching her, but I said, she's just unbelievable.
Unbelievable. Yeah. She totally transformed into that character.
She really did. It's funny because that scene, we shot like on the third day or fourth day, we shot that block party. Oh my God, that's a story too. But in that scene, it was I remember in the edit, I could see that was the day like she really dropped into the character. Like she does something in that scene. I was watching it. And I was like, yeah, she's it now. She's got it.
Mm-hmm.
And knew she had it from then on. We shot that out in Bay Ridge, and we were shooting a block party. And you know, the police come and they shut off the blocks. And our contact with the New York City police decided to not shut the street, so we had to run cars through our block party. Every time I called cut, I had to run cars through. I mean, we were in the middle of Bay Ridge. There was no, he just, that's what he wanted to do.
So when you yell cut, all of a sudden,
I had to run cars
2014 through. SUVs driving through.
Yeah. And exactly. I stopped calling cut. I just stopped.
Well, I was going to say, otherwise it could take you days once you have to let traffic through.
Yeah, that day was a big one. It was big and long and lots of people. Yeah.
What do you miss about New York in 1992?
I don't like to, it's funny, I'm just going to say I don't like to look back and I make a movie that takes place in 1992, but I think I like, you know, when I moved from the Bronx into Manhattan, I was living in Tribeca, and it was sort of on the edge. It was nowhere, you know. And when I went out to Brooklyn, I felt still again on the edge. And then there's no more edges. I don't know where to go. I'm gonna fall off the edge. There's no more edges in New York. Yeah.
I missed the $1 subway token.
Oh, yeah.
Wasn't it about a dollar then?
You, in 1992, I was like in fifth grade.
All right. the Vincent Piazza character, this is a guy who's trying to be something that he's not. There are a lot of people in New York trying to be something that they're not.
Yeah, certainly.
This guy is like delusional a little bit, though.
He certainly is. Yeah, I mean, he's desperate. He is.
He just wants to be a part of it so badly.
So bad, desperately. He wants to be something he's not. I mean, I spent 25 years, I made my career about being somebody I'm not. So I relate to that desire.
Well, speaking of, everyone here knows and loves you as Caputo Orange is the New Black. And so today you started shooting.
Episode 13, yeah.
Of season.
They're probably not allowed to say that. You're not allowed to say anything.
Okay.
Yes, episode 13 of the fourth season, yeah. We're wrapping it up. We're close.
Run us back, like it was August 2011 when Lionsgate said that they were going to cast a series called Orange is the New Black.
Yeah. Mm.
This is before House of Cards was on Netflix, yeah. And everybody knew that there was original programming on Netflix. When somebody came to you and said, we want you to star in a Netflix show, did you even understand what that was? That
no.
This was going to be a big thing in television?
I had no idea. I don't think any of us really had an idea. I got the script. I was only supposed to do maybe two or three of them, episodes.
Hmm.
So I wasn't even cast as a regular the first two seasons. But I wound up doing every show. And I got the script, and they said, oh, you'll be making this amount of money. And I said, no, really? Not that. It can't be, right? And they said, no, yeah, it's not. It's not really that great. It's Netflix. And I read the script, and I just was like, this script is amazing. I'll do it. And for me, that meant it was not going to go anywhere. Because whenever I'm passionately in love with, you know, something, I read something, I'm like, you know, like eight people see it. So I was totally wrong. I had no idea. I don't think any of us did.
Well, and also at the time, I don't want to say that, I feel like a lot of these actors, we first know them now from Orange is the New Black. So there's no main A-list star that you can sort of hook onto and say, well, that person's in it, so we're good.
Right on. I mean, and I think that must have been the plan early on. I mean, even the way they sort of shifted the focus of the show. You know, they, you know, Genji talks about the Piper character being the Trojan horse, you know, that sort of lets people into the show. And boy, did she, what has come out of that horse has just been unbelievable.
We talked about that a lot, my husband and I, when we were watching it, that the first season was all Piper and everything led back to Piper. But now there are so many major storylines that happen that have nothing to do with her.
Yeah. Yeah, it's pretty amazing. She knew what she had. She knew what she can, as a storyteller, what she can get away with. And she just moved focus where she, and she moves it where she wants to. She's unbelievable.
Yeah. Can you tell us anything about the new season?
I can say that
it's good TV.
Yeah.
Hey, no way! He was gonna tell us something good.
I'm sorry.
No,
really, I could say that you know they moved us into the drama category. We were up for first
comedy.
Season was up for comedy, and then this season we were up for drama. I think we Genji may have her drama Emmy this season. It's really powerful. It's really strong and. It's unflinching. It's pretty great. Yeah. Powerful stuff.
Well, we're excited about it.
Yeah, I am. You could tell I am. I'm blown away. I mean, this last three scripts, 11, 12, and 13, I'm like, whoa. I mean, people have to watch them together. They're just unbelievable.
Well, we do. We binge like 13 hours at a time.
Nobody watches just one, right? It's that like countdown, that 6 seconds where you look at your girlfriend or boyfriend, and like, all right, one more.
And then on the weekend when a Netflix series releases, you will have people who are on Twitter, and literally it's 13 hours to the minute after it released that they've announced that they've watched all the episodes.
Oh, yeah.
It's unbelievable.
That's commitment.
Yeah.
It is commitment. And then if you run into that person in a coffee shop.
Oh, don't talk to me.
After.
Do not talk to me.
Like, they've been watching for like 24 hours straight and they see you in a coffee shop. I think people are affected differently when they're sitting home watching 6, 8, 10 hours.
Yeah.
And then, you know, I just think it affects people in a different way.
Nick, you told Jamie earlier that you love the subway system. What does that mean?
What does it mean? I know everybody thinks I'm crazy for that. I just have a real passion for the subway. Now it's become a bit of a circus. I mean, it's a little bit crazy now because of the show. It's become...
You can't ride the subway without people
freaking
out about you.
I still do. I'm committed to it because I really love it. I feel really at ease on the subway. It's like meditation for me, and I love being around... I know it's absurd.
Well, as much as there are delays and problems, et cetera,
yes.
I always say that it is a small miracle every time you get on, and I don't even know what the cost of one ride is, $275?
It is $275.
$275. You are transported to sometimes another universe.
It's unbelievable. I mean, the people, every shape, size, color, you know, you got rich people, poor people, it's all in one box in the city. It's just unbelievable. I love it so much, I told I mentioned to you, I was away, I was in Vancouver doing a film, and I was away for about a month and a half. I'm in New York, I've always lived here, so just passionate about the city. It's a great love of my life, and I was missing home, obviously, and I was watching a documentary, and they were interviewing somebody on the subway, and I welled up. I swear to God, and it wasn't the content of the documentary.
You're like, oh my God, I miss Showtime.
Oh my God, I welled up on the subway. Yeah, about the subway, it's absurd.
Well, have you been to either of the new-ish, I guess now, the Fulton Center stop?
Nope. No, it's not my stop. What am I doing? I'm going to go to... Why am I going to
Subway tourism, right?
I mean, I love the subway, but I'm not a tourist. I mean, I go where I'm going to go.
Right. I went the day that the Hudson Yards station opened.
Yeah, but you're the traffic reporter.
But if you love the subway, it is a beautiful station. You should go see it.
I'm going to go, yes.
All right.
I will go.
You can go, Nick, you can go right now.
I'll go see you guys.
Upon the conclusion of your visit to us. Thank you for coming in tonight.
Hey, thank you, it was great. A lot of fun.
The Wannabe, December 4th in theaters. Nick Sandow, ladies and gentlemen.
Thank you. Appreciate it. Thanks for all your help.
Thank you so much.
Bye-bye.
You guys doing good still? 90-20, yeah? So we have a lot more coming up.
I'm gonna look through those.
I think our trivia girls can probably head over to that magic door. Yeah, don't make it awkward for them, guys. They're going to walk in front of you. There we go. That's Christine over there. Give it up for Christine, guys. She helps make this happen. And now, the moment you've all been waiting for. It's trivia time, I believe.
It is.
It is. I love the trivia music.
NYC Pop Quiz.
Hi there. Hi, Jamie. Nice to meet you.
I'm going to get your names for the record, please. Closest to me, your name?
Ilana.
Christina. Ilana's up against Christina. So...
Oh, we should mention trivia is like your thing.
Yeah.
For people who don't know.
3 or 4 times a year at the Bell House in Brooklyn, I get together with a company called TrivWorks.
Mm-hmm.
And TrivWorks, here for TrivWorks. David Jacobson at TrivWorks produces corporate trivia events.
Yeah.
The kind of thing that you can... do for an office party as a bonding exercise, but he also produces my trivia events at the Bell House. We get like 300 people in the room and it's a trivia showdown.
Oh, it's fun. People are drinking, but at the same time that they're drinking, they are dead serious about the trivia.
No, they're very, very serious about the
trivia.
And
the questions are hard, we should be clear, not these as much, but the ones at your trivia nights, I'm like, yeah.
So we wanted to bring a bit of that energy to the show, and we have a 6-set question series all about New York City. You guys, are you ready for this? Okay, so we're going to play World Series of Pop Culture Rules, which is, I ask the question to one of you, if the other doesn't, if you don't get the answer, the other gets a chance to jump in and try to answer the question. Ilana, you will go first. These are all questions about television programs set in New York City. Ilana, what fictional New York City newspaper did Carrie Bradshaw write for on Sex and the City?
New York Star?
Is correct, yes.
Good for you. I thought that was hard.
Ilana's up 1-0. Did you know that?
I actually didn't.
Are
I
you too young for Sex and the City?
I saw, no!
Christina? Christina or Christina?
Christina.
Christina, your question 2. Upon its finale in 2007, what show set in New York City became the last live-action sitcom that premiered in the 90s to end its run? It premiered in the 90s. It lasted longer than any other live-action sitcom from the 90s and was set in New York.
No.
Would you like to guess?
Tell me.
No, don't tell her.
I don't know.
Time's up. Ilana, can you steal?
Yeah. Was it Law and Order?
It was not Law and Order. It was the King of Queens.
Live action
sitcom. You know, a shot before a studio audience.
I know. I do think that was like a little bit of a trick question.
Okay, you're not allowed to question the wording of the questions. You're on my team, Jamie Stelter. Ilana, this is for you to take a 2-0 lead. On the show Seinfeld, who said, these latkes are going like hotcakes?
Latkes?
These latkes.
George?
Incorrect.
Wah.
Christina, who said these latkes are going like hotcakes?
Kramer's
correct. We are tied at one with 3 questions to go. Christina, this is your question. On the show Seinfeld, who said, "You can stuff all your stories in a sack, mister"?
George.
Correct, it is George.
Nice.
Christina's up 2-1. Ilana, your final question. On the air from 1999 to 2005, what NBC drama portrayed the lives of New York City emergency responders working at a fictional precinct during the 3 p.m. to 11 p.m. shift?
1995 till?
1999 to 2000, an NBC drama.
NYPD Blue?
Incorrect. For the steal and the win, Christina?
Help? I don't know.
It was Third Watch. 2-1, one question remaining. Christina, you have a commanding lead. With a correct answer, Christina, you will lock this up and take the grand prize. Question 6, what was the very first of the Law & Order spin-offs?
SVU.
SVU is correct for the win. Christina, you are our grand prize winner. A 3-month membership to the May Center here at the 92nd Street Y. All the fitness you can jam into 3 months. And Ilana, we have a prize for you as well, also courtesy of the 92nd Street Y. 92Y has 2 tickets to an upcoming show. There are so many to choose from. Zach Posen's on the calendar coming up. Malcolm Gladwell's on the calendar coming up. There it is, yes. Stacey London, apparently that's how she'll use her prize. Round of applause for Christina and Ilana.
Thank you.
Did you check the hashtag?
I did.
Okay, you got questions?
Yeah.
The final act of our show is
question and answer.
We have
some good
questions.
Should
I vet these or they're okay?
Well, I just vetted them.
I know, but I'm nervous when you get to vet them and I don't. I'm used to being in the big box and you're in the little box on TV.
Oh. Thank you, thank you.
Well, because then I get to decide when we're done talking. And no, do whatever you want, Jim.
Pat, question 1. Do you wear pants while you sit at the desk?
Yeah. This is as casual as I ever get. I'll wear a cotton pant sometimes, but usually.
You're like, I would say 98% of the time
full suit. Yeah.
You know, I'm terrified.
I'm terrified that something big is going to happen, and then the mayor is going to end up next to me, and I'll have shorts on.
It's true. I'm actually the one who wears sneakers and Birkenstocks.
Your footwear is almost inexcusable.
Yeah.
Because you get the impression that Jamie's all done up, but it's only from here up. And it's
that's all you see of me in my little box.
I know, but I could. Next.
I like this one for Pat. You are on jury duty. If your jury duty experience this week was a New York Post headline, what would it be? You can't legally say
no,
much.
No, I gotta tread really carefully because I can't talk about anything, really. As I said, it is a slice of every bit of New York City. But I need to come up with a pun that doesn't break my clause of confidentiality. Okay, go to the next one. I'm working on this one.
Okay. Someone asked, is the morning show live? It loops every 30 minutes. And I know that our boss is here, and he told me he was gonna heckle me about this. But our traffic tosses and my traffic reports are always live. So if you tune in at 08 and 38 past the hour, you are always getting live updates.
Right. What do you mean by that?
They're asking, is the morning show live?
Oh, even if there's
parts of it.
Yes,
are
even
live.
If there's a portion of it that's taped, the traffic will never be previously recorded.
Right. So that's what I'm saying. Someone asks, is the morning show live? And my answer is, the traffic is always live.
Right.
Do you see what I mean?
So you've basically hung me out to dry.
Pat's always giving you the most up-to-date headlines on New York One.
No, the theory behind New York One, and this isn't a well-kept secret,
right?
That is that if, say, I'm reading the intro to George Whipple's story about the party he attended the night before,
right?
If I read that at 5:54 a.m.,
right, an evergreen story like that is not changing.
I don't need to read that again at 9:54 a.m. They will pull that back from the video server and give me a little break because I'm up there for a long time.
You poor thing, all by yourself in your big box.
So here's my New York Post headline.
Oh.
From the big box to the jury box.
Good one. Good one. That was good on the spot. We'll do two more questions,
okay.
I guess. How does a Canadian become the voice that wakes up New York City? What brought you here? What keeps you here, besides me?
Our boss, Steve Paulus.
I added that part.
Our boss, Steve Paulus, is in the audience.
I know.
He was the one who tapped me on the shoulder and said, do you want to be the morning anchor? It was a nice moment. I came to New York for another job at Time Warner.
Okay.
And I was here for just long enough that I was sort of barely qualified as a New Yorker when I joined New York One. Because you can't just come in from Canada and jump into New York One.
No.
We're all New York all the time. Like, that'd be like coming in from Philadelphia and all of a sudden being a New Yorker. Do you have to be born in New York to be a New Yorker?
Oh.
Oh.
Wow.
Okay, wait. Let me ask the question the other way. Can you be from somewhere else, be born somewhere else, move to New York, and consider yourself a New Yorker? Thank you.
Yes.
You said you have one more?
I consider myself a New Yorker. I've been here for 10 years. This is where I live. This is where I work. Oh, wow, no. Hey, talk to me in another 10 years, Jamie. Well, this will lead us out. We're going to talk about when the next... someone said, are there going to be more Pat and Jamie's New York? Mm-hmm. The answer is yes. And we're going to tell you... we'll tell you all the details of that in a moment. But I actually wanted to take a moment first and talk about someone's very special day tomorrow. If you didn't know already... it is somebody's birthday. Vice President Joe Biden. So you should wish him happy birthday on Twitter. But in person, it is Pat Kiernan's birthday tomorrow. So I thought we could all join in and sing happy birthday.
Thank you.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday.
I actually meant to get a cupcake or a cake or something, but like it was raining, I was stuck in traffic, and I was like, "Hey."
So I got nothing.
You got a snack.
We can go get a cupcake after.
Aw.
Yeah. Okay. By the way, after the show, we're gonna come down and say hi as well. So if you have to race off into the rain, you can. But we'd love to say hi to you as well.
Right. But first, we should tell you that we put the video up afterwards of the show if you want to send it to any of your friends or family who missed it. We also put the show up as a podcast after.
Yes, the video will be up on the 92Y On Demand site. We have patandjamie.com. We'll put the audio up there in podcast form. Subscribe, download, listen to it in your car.
Yeah, and then we do have two more installments on the calendar for Pat and Jamie's New York. The next one is Thursday, January 28th. And then there's one in March as well. All the dates are on our website.
Okay. I'm back to jury duty tomorrow. You're on your own.
I'm off.
Oh. Okay. Well, I guess this is the last
time
you'll
see us. This is a late night for me.
It is. Thanks for coming out, everybody. Good to be here with you.
That was Pat and Jamie's New York. That was Pat and Jamie's New York. Yeah, that was Pat and Jamie's New York. That was Pat.